So today's video, I'm going to discuss about how to do a PhD in the USA. So this is based on my own experience and the experience of many students who have gone there to do a PhD. So I presume at this point that you have got admission and scholarship into a PhD program and you are planning to start your PhD. Now, the first thing which is very important is to choose your PhD supervisor properly and correctly. So this is something which is so important that it can be repeated numerous times and still it does not lose its relevance. So why this is so is because compared to your bachelor's degree and even master's degree program, the PhD supervisor plays an enormous role in your life, and he or she has somewhat draconian powers relative to your research growth as well as career. So you need to make sure that this person has a good wavelength with you and is a good match for you. So let me look at some of the aspects about why you should choose your PhD guide properly. One is that many of the PhD students are tied to some sort of funding, and this funding typically comes from a particular person, and this person is likely to be your PhD supervisor. So it is very hard to change your PhD supervisor without causing substantial consternation in the entire department, because it is likely to set a precedent, and typically PhD students are tied to some research program. And so professors do not want to set a precedent in terms of letting students change their PhD guide or their topics, so on and so on. So it's very important to make sure that when you join a university, you have given a lot of thought to the PhD supervisor and to the research topic, and you have selected this particular combination properly. The second aspect is that the research goals of the student and the supervisor should match. So if the student is interested in experimental work, the supervisor should have the same type of interest. If the student is interested in computational or mathematical research, then he or she should match themselves with a supervisor who has the same goals. So again, this is very important because you don't want to go to a university and then you find out that your supervisor wants you to do a largely experimental project and your aim was to do a theoretical project. So you need to resolve these things before you join. The third aspect is that wavelength of the supervisor and the student should match. And in this, I mean that they should have similar long-term and short-term goals in terms of research and similar philosophies. So this is something you need to keep in mind. Simultaneously, it is sometimes useful that the supervisor and the student are kind of complementary. So what I mean by that is that if you are a person who does not need much supervision, who has a clearly laid out research plan and is self-motivated, then you may benefit from a supervisor who is kind of benign in terms of his guidance, does not do much micromanagement and leaves you to do your task and just periodically checks on your progress. On the contrary, if you are somebody who is not very meticulous in terms of research, who is prone to procrastination and is not a good manager of his or her time, then you may benefit from a supervisor who is a strict disciplinarian, who is somewhat of a martinet and so on. So what this person may do is he or she may set weekly meetings on Monday, Wednesday, Friday at 9 o'clock in the morning. And this will force you to make good progress toward your research and to finish your PhD quite rapidly. So again, these are some things to keep in mind as to what is your particular personality type and what type of supervision do you really need and what is the type of supervision which will actually benefit you. So one more important thing is to do a lot of research on your supervisor before you join the university. And this is particularly true if you are an international student, because once you have joined a particular program, you may be on a visa and it will be very difficult for you to change your supervisor at this stage. So again, you may not have gone to that particular country or university and met the person, but nowadays there is a lot of material in the social media which you can use to find out more about a particular person. And you can also ask former students at the same university or students who are currently working in the same university about a particular person. And you can take the help of WhatsApp or Facebook Messenger or FaceTime video chat formats to talk to these people and to check out about the particular person. Because what happens is that PhD supervisors vary a lot in temperament, and some can be kind of benevolent, but some are also saturnine and to some extent even Mephistophelian. So you need to be very careful about the type of supervisor you are choosing, because once you land up with the wrong person, it is very hard to continue with that person, and you may have to end up leaving the PhD program. And if you are a foreign student, you may also have to leave the country with an unfinished degree, which may not be the best outcome of this particular situation. So now I presume that you have got a supervisor with whom you are getting along quite well and you are going through your program. So the first thing you need to do is you need to choose a number of courses which you need to complete. So typically the US PhD system has a lot of coursework requirement, and I think this is one of the positive aspects of this particular system. So again, the courses you take will be primarily decided by your PhD supervisor in conjunction with discussions with you, and you can select courses based on your research field. And I would also suggest you take a minor if possible, and two minors if that is possible. So you can minor in some field like mathematics, or you can minor in computer science or something like that. And this will not only enhance your research potential, but also enhance your possibility of getting jobs at the end of your PhD program. The other thing is that you need to know a variety of professors beside your PhD supervisor, and the courses also help you to know the different professors in the department and in different departments, and these people can become useful to you in terms of not only people who are in your PhD committee, but also people who are required sometime from external departments to be in your PhD committee and help to guide your work. Now, one of the features about the US PhD system is a written qualifying exam, which is there in most places. And in this situation, you need to take exam on two or three or more subjects. And this is a comprehensive exam, which is based on the coursework you have completed. And very frequently, these exams may not even be set by the people whose courses you have taken. So they may be set by somebody else. And this is one of the tough challenges in terms of a PhD degree in the USA. And I think this also helps to ensure the quality of the degree is at a high standard, because it's not easy to pass this qualifying exam. And typically PhD students in USA who have completed their PhD program have passed this qualifying exam. Now, similar to the written qualifiers, there is a verbal test type of situation where you have to essentially defend your research proposal in front of a committee. And this is typically a committee of professors who is selected or created to guide your thesis in a broad sense. So your thesis is basically guided by your PhD supervisor, but this particular committee can be there to help support the work and to provide some sort of directionality or boundaries in terms of the growth of your thesis. And committee members are often useful in terms of pointing out the different lacunas which may be there in your research proposal. And so you should take the criticism properly and look into the possible scenarios where you can solve some of the criticisms which they have raised, or you can look at solutions to those criticisms. And sometimes it may also lead to these people becoming joint writers of some of the papers which you create. Now, one of the things you should do when you go to a PhD program is you should try to go to a few conferences, and I would suggest you go to some of the major conferences in the field and present your work. And you should not only present your work, but you should also try to go to the different talks which are going on, including the keynote lectures and the plenary talks and so on. And so you have a good feeling about the entire field of research and not just your narrow subfield in which you are doing PhD. So this is very important because I very frequently see students putting all that time in their own talk, going to the speaker's briefing room, preparing and so on. And then once that talk is finished, they are touring the city or seeing different sites and so on. And this is not a proper use of the conference venue, because you should make sure that you use the time to attend the various talks which are there in the conference, because this is one of the main privileges that you get in terms of being a PhD student. Now, of course, conferences are important, but journals are the most important thing as far as research is concerned. So again, try to publish a few journal papers. Now, if you have a relatively younger guide, then he or she may actually be more motivated than you in terms of journal publication. And so there will be pressure on you to publish papers. If you have a very senior guide, he or she may not be very motivated to publish papers which are not very seminal to the field. So you may have to push this particular senior supervisor to publish papers, because it's more in your interest to expand your curriculum vitae, and his curriculum vitae may be very long at this stage, and he may be looking more into administration and such things. So again, I would suggest target 3 to 5 journal papers during your PhD, and target maybe 1 to 5 conference papers at the same time. And some of these conference papers may also become journal papers later, especially if you are presenting in society conferences and they are linked to society journals, then some of this transfer is possible. Now, you can also use this time to go to some symposiums and workshops which keep going on at different universities. There are various thesis exams which are going on at the universities. Seminars by different experts are also given, and so you can go to these seminars and expand your knowledge. One more thing I would suggest that you do is that you create a curriculum vitae of your own at the second year of your PhD. At this point, your CV may be very weak, you may have no publications or one publication, but it's a good concept to create it at this stage so you exactly know what is expected of you in terms of the growth of your CV. And so you know which are the gaps in your CV in terms of publications, prizes you need to get, maybe small grants you need to go for, and so on. So again, this helps you to grow as a research person. Now, many people are funded by TA or by like research grants during this process. So again, you need to take this particular work very seriously, because good performance in these particular venues is required to continue your financial aid. So if you are a TA, you may have to go and teach classes or help in grading classes and so on. So again, take these tasks very seriously, and also these become good points to write in your CV later. Now, if you are working in terms of a research proposal, you may have to present your work to different people who are funding the grant. And again, these provide a good source of getting to know a lot of people in the research community, and to get to know the people who are the scientists in various national labs and so on. And these people can help you get jobs later, or they can be also reference writers for you later when you are looking for jobs and so on. So again, one more thing I would suggest is that you write out an outline of your PhD thesis in terms of the table of content around the second or third year of your thesis. And this also forces you to know what are the basic chapter names and some of the top sections which you have. And you can discuss this with your PhD supervisor to ensure that you both are on the same page as far as your PhD is concerned. So he or she should suddenly not create a new problem, such as an experimental study which has to be done in the fourth year of your thesis or something like that, and that can significantly expand your problem. So you need to be very clear about what is your research problem right by the second or third year of your particular thesis. Now, one more thing you should do is you should start looking for jobs or postdocs by the end of your thesis, but don't wait till the very end. So when you are seeing that your thesis is coming to a close, you should start tapping the job market and make some plan to have some future jobs and postdocs and so on. And also, typically in the US system, the defense is done within the university. So essentially you have 4 or 5 professors in the department, and you have one external professor. So he may be from a different department. And then you essentially present your work to these people in a long defense, which may be 45 minutes or more. And you also give your thesis copy to all these people. So essentially this particular set of people is satisfied with your thesis, that is a good situation. If they are dissatisfied with your thesis, then you may have to make different correction and so on. So I have rarely seen situations where people's thesis has been actually turned down, because this review system is typically in the department. And so if you have a good wavelength match in terms of your research with your supervisor and with different professors in the department, that should not be a particular problem in getting your thesis through with this particular PhD committee. So once you are presenting this thesis, you are finished with it, then the committee members will basically thank you and they will say that you have now become a doctor. And so that is the point at which your PhD has come to an end. And then you can do the necessary paperwork, and after some time you will get the PhD degree from the particular university. And then you can go to the commencement and collect your degree at that point. So this is a basic outline about how you get a PhD degree in the United States. And that system is very different, or somewhat different, from that practiced in different Commonwealth countries and different European countries and so on. So those systems are somewhat different, and I will make more videos about those particular systems for students who are aspiring to do their PhD in those countries. So I think this video was probably helpful for you. And so please stay tuned to my channel for further videos on such topics. Thank you very much.